He would play with all the kids. He would measure their arms so he could tickle them. He loved to scare them by telling him if they were bad, that he would let the goats out of the shed. And I now play those same games with my dad. My dad was full of advice for me. He'd bang on the window and he'd say, "Don't stay up too late." He'd remind me when I got ice out of the refrigerator not to take too much. And not to talk too loud. I can hear you. You don't have to talk so loud. Spending quality time with my dad was just not the same without these things being said. So I continued to do them. Just so I could hear his response and laugh. My dad was the most positive man I knew. I learned all about life from my dad. He made you a better person just by knowing him. I never wanted to admit he was sick, so I'd always just tell him, "Dad, I'll see you tomorrow. Love you." And he would always say back, "I love you too. And I'm sure glad you got to see me again." Thank you. Thank you all for coming.
Good job.
Thank you.
I'm glad you got to see the room.
I think everybody was.
Listening to that, it makes me mindful of two things that I look for at a time like this. One is tears, because Jim is greatly loved, and he is greatly missed. I'm so thankful that God included in the Bible the story of when Jesus' friend Lazarus died. At that moment, we get the shortest verse in the Bible. Any biblical scholars here? Jesus wept. And I've always glossed over that verse and just went on with the rest of the story. And a few years ago, God had me stop. And just the simple question, why? If anybody had an eternal perspective on things, it's Jesus. Why did he cry? And I came up with two answers. The first one, Jesus cried because it hurts. It hurts to lose someone you love. It hurts to lose someone like Papa Jim. So cry. I will be the last person in the world to tell you don't cry. The other reason I think Jesus cried is to let us know it's okay. It's okay. We can have the hope and comfort of heaven and still hurt. And it's okay to cry. So one thing I look for is tears. The other thing I look for is, you've just demonstrated for me, is laughter. You know what? If Jim were here with us today, he'd probably be pulling a prank on one of us. Okay? And he'd be in the middle of it, and he'd be laughing with us. So honor him with your laughter. Tell the story. Laugh together. Keep his memory alive in your hearts. I wasn't even planning on sharing that, so no extra charge for that. All right. What I wanted to share with you today is something I want to get straight. And it starts in the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus himself said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. One thing we need to understand today. Jim has not left home. Jim has gone home. And now that he's at home, some things are different. He's got a new body. Paul says that we will put on a heavenly body. I don't know about you, but when I wake up in the morning, it's like Rice Krispies. Snap, crackle, and pop. Just bad back, bad knees, bad ears. Just, oh. But the body we get in heaven will never ache. We'll never have pain. We'll never get tired. Jim's got a new house. Jesus said, in my Father's house there are many mansions. Now, I've had the wonderful opportunity to travel literally all over this world. And I've seen vast mountain ranges and huge deserts and oceans, incredible forests. And I think to myself, God did all this in 6 days. He's been working on our home for over 2,000 years. I can't wait to get there. The Bible says that there's great food in heaven. In Matthew 8, many will come from the east and the west to sit at the feasting table of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, I don't know what kind of food they have in heaven, but I can guarantee you it beats Taco Tuesday. Jim has already had a chance to talk with some of his favorite Bible characters. He was able to ask Moses, what were you thinking as you stood at the Red Sea and parted the water? He's able to ask David, what was going through your mind as you stood up against Goliath, the giant? He's asked Noah the all-important question, where did you keep the termites? He's had a chance to talk with Daniel, with Peter, with Paul. He's been reunited with loved ones who've gone on before him. The Bible is clear that in heaven we will see and recognize each other. I think John, the writer of the book of Revelation, was one of the most frustrated writers ever when God gave him a glimpse into heaven. And I think John saw things that he just couldn't describe. There were these 24 creatures, and they had wings, and they flew. I think John saw colors we haven't seen. I think he saw things that we can't even comprehend. What John did describe was a place where the streets are made of gold, the walls are made of precious stones, the gates are made of single giant pearls. In heaven, there's the river of life, the tree of life, the crystal sea. Jesus himself calls it paradise. With everything that there is in heaven, there are some things that aren't there. There's no more hunger. There's no more thirst. There's no more death. There will be no more memorial services. There's no more tears. There's no more pain. There's no sun or moon in heaven. And it's always today in heaven. The worst gift you could buy God is a watch. And with that in mind, we all are stuck in time, and we have time to miss Jim. Jim does not have time to miss us. When we die, and everyone in this room will die, from Jim's perspective, it's going to be like we were right behind him in line. There are no churches in heaven because the object of our worship is there. There's no sin in heaven. Jim's house may not have a door lock on it. For that matter, it may not even have a door. There's no more falling. I don't know about you. I sometimes get tired of living in a fallen world, where on the news we find out how much people can hate each other. And if I'm really honest with you, I get tired of my own sin. Well, in heaven, everything will be perfect and complete. We will lack for nothing. We will fall one last time when we fall at Jesus' feet and worship Him. And that makes me a little jealous for Jim. He's already getting to do what I long to do, and that's see my Savior face to face. And I know if Jim were here, he would want me to tell you, how do you get there? Okay? Well, thanks to the great theologian Tim Tebow, we are all familiar with the Bible verse John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life. My question to you today is, what's eternal life? Living forever? That's boring. Fortunately, Jesus answers the question for us. If you remember John 3:16, transpose the numbers a little bit and go to John 17:3. And Jesus uses a real clever phrase as He says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know You, the one true God, and Your Son whom You sent." See, getting to heaven, it's not about what rules you keep. It's not about what church you go to. It's about who you know. And more importantly, who knows you? Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, as the Apostle Paul wrote, we have hope. We have the hope of knowing that we will see Jim again, that we will be reunited. But this is not goodbye, but we'll see you soon. But Father, that hope is not based in a church or a doctrine. It's based in Your character, in Your promise. Father, I pray that You would give us strength. Strength to keep putting one foot in front of the other, that we might go on and live lives that would honor Jim. And in so doing, may we live lives that honor You. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
It was very important, as I spoke with Janet, that we end today on a positive note. So we've got one more song for you to close our service.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and for you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue, clouds of white, the bright blessed day, and dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. bells. What a wonderful world. Oh yeah.
Continue to honor Jim with your lives. Let your life be his legacy. God bless you all and give you peace.